One of the biggest concerns that I get on this channel in the comment section is Christians feeling really confused about what it is the Bible says about being armed or concealed carrying. And the Bible does happen to say a lot about that. So I wanted to take this episode and really dedicate to what is it God says about being a concealed carrier. And even we're going to talk about things like what about Jesus saying turn the other cheek? So we're going to start by saying God himself is a warrior. Exodus 15:3 will tell you, the Lord is a man of war. The Lord is his name. And God loves a warrior. However, we've seen in the Bible a lot of times where people were to take up arms specifically for the things of God. Nehemiah is a great example. What's taking place in Nehemiah is the Jews have just been set free from Babylon by the Persians, and Nehemiah has been sent back by the king to rebuild the wall around Jerusalem. And there's many adversaries trying to stop him from doing that. And we'll pick it up in chapter 4, verse 8. And all them conspired together to come and attack Jerusalem and create confusion. Nevertheless, we made our prayer to our God, and because of them, we set a watch against them day and night. So here with Nehemiah begins with prayer. We're going to come back to that. We'll pick it up in 15. And it happened when our enemies heard that it was known to us, and that God had brought their counsel to nothing, that all of us returned to the wall, everyone to his work. So it was from that time on that half of my servants worked at construction, while the other half held spears and shields, the bows and war armor, and the leaders were behind all the houses of Judah. Those who built on the wall and those who carried burdens loaded themselves so that one hand they worked at construction and with the other they held a weapon. Every one of the builders had his sword girded at his side as he built, and the one who sounded the trumpet was beside me. Then I said to the nobles, the rulers, and the rest of the people, the work is great and extensive, and we are separated far from one another on the wall. Therefore, wherever you hear the sound of the trumpet, rally to us there. Our God will fight for us. Now, they were within the will of God. They were doing the work of God, and God was with them, but they still had to stay armed. You know, a lot of people also ask the question, well, if you trust God, why do you need a gun? Great question. God himself will fight for you, but often, not always, but often, that means you are armed and you are actually doing the fighting. But often, and again, not always, God does all of the fighting. If you look at the Israelites' flight from Egypt, he completely destroyed the Egyptians when they came after him. They didn't have to do anything, and that's when they sang that song, God is a Warrior, in Exodus. Psalm 18:34 says, he teaches my hands to make war so that my arms can bend a bow of bronze. Now what he's talking about is God trains you for so and gives you supernatural strength, and he allows you to do things that you can't do on your own, so you really need God there with you. If you trust God, why do you need a gun? Well, that's exactly why. Everything I just said there. All right, well, what about Jesus telling his disciples to turn the other cheek? Great question. What Jesus was referring to is he was sending them out to strange towns that they were not from to preach the gospel in those towns. And oftentimes they were met with criticism, and sometimes people were so upset at what they had to say that they would strike them. In those moments, you're just to turn the other cheek and leave. He's talking about if you're ministering the word of God and you meet opposition, just walk away. That's on them, is exactly what Jesus meant. He didn't mean that if somebody comes in your house to murder your family that you should turn the other cheek. Of course you shouldn't turn the other cheek. The righteous man who falters before the wicked is like a murky spring, a polluted well, Proverbs 25:28 tells us. You know, on Jesus last night, during the Last Supper, he had a lot to say to the disciples. Jesus knew that the very next day he would be nailed to a cross, but that was his mission. He was particularly there on that mission. He wasn't there to stay alive or flee from this threat. He was there, born and raised, to be in this moment of death because that takes away the sin of the world. Now, he knew the disciples would be okay as long as he was with them, but this night, this was his last night with them. And he told them in Luke 22:35, when I sent you without money bag, sack, and sandals, did you lack anything? So they said, nothing. Then he said to them, but now he who has a money bag, let him take it, and likewise a sack, and he who has no sword, let him sell his garment and buy one. For I say to you that this which is written must still be accomplished in me. And he was numbered with the transgressors, for the things concerning me have an end. Then they said, Lord, look, here are two swords. And he said to them, it is enough. So everything Jesus said in that moment was, I'm here specifically to die. I have a mission, and when I sent you out before this night, you were always okay because you had God with you. But now, I'm going to be nailed to a cross and I won't be back for 3 days. So you're going to need a sword, and if you don't have one, you need to go get one. Later that same night, as Jesus was getting arrested, Peter pulled a sword and he chopped the ear off of a temple soldier. And Jesus told him to stop, said, he who lives by the sword dies by the sword. Now, he told that to Peter for two reasons. One, Jesus was there to be captured again, and he was on a mission to get nailed to a cross. Two, he had something much better for Peter than fighting, much different for Peter. He was going to be the leader of the church. It was very important that Peter not be a warrior in that moment, that Peter just lay down his sword. Otherwise, he's going to get killed. He needed him to be the leader of the church now, not some guy that chops off the ears of temple guards. So, I hope this video helps. You know, in the end, really what's going on here is we are in a world that is filled with evil, and you're not to be out committing evil. Obviously, those people don't be armed. The defenders of the fatherless and the widows, those people need to be armed. Because the Bible also tells us, blessed is the peacekeepers, for they shall be called the sons of God. Hope this video helps. Love to hear your comments on this. Put them in below. If you like this video, click like and subscribe. If you feel called to support our channel at the Patreon, that link is also below. But the most important part of this channel is we take prayer requests, so never hesitate to send that in. Thank you for watching this episode of God, Family, and Guns. And as always, love God, love your family, and love guns.